Matthew.
Guido.
Wie ben je?
Ik ben Matthew Niederberger. Ik ben een,
Vertel, wat doe je allemaal?
Eigenlijk alleen maar tech management. Ik probeer mijn dagelijks leven bezig te houden met het verbeteren, implementeren en effectief neerzetten van tech management implementaties.
En hoe breed hebben we het dan? Hebben we het dan over Google Tag Manager of qua tooling?
Ik denk dat het per land verschillend is. Ik merk dat ik met Amerikaanse klanten meer met Segment aan het werk ben.
Oh ja, ja. Segment.io volgens mij.
.com hebben ze. .com? Oh, die hebben ze kunnen bemachtigen.
Ze begonnen als Segment.io. Ja,
ze hebben een investeringronde gedaan waarbij ze eindelijk .com konden kopen.
Ja, 3 miljoen investering, 2,5 miljoen voor
de domeinnaam. Ja. Nee, in Nederland is het vooral Google Tag Manager. Dat zie je toch wel als, de investering in Nederland is nog niet op het niveau als Amerika.
Ja.
Dus qua tooling wordt er vaak wel gekeken naar de meer freemium tools.
Ja. Zoals Google Tag Manager.
Zoals Google Tag Manager, inderdaad.
Ja, andere tools die populair zijn? Of zijn dat wel de twee eigenlijk?
En waar ik me mee bezig houd eigenlijk is eigenlijk... Ik zeg toch meestal 95% Google Tag Manager. En er zijn wel klanten in Nederland. T-Leams die ook al enigszins voorbij komen. Ja. En Adobe, maar de combinaties zijn dan vaak Adobe met Tealium als de tag management platform, zeg maar.
Oké. En wat doe je dan vooral voor die bedrijven? Is het vooral het opzetten, inrichten? Of komen ze bij jou van, nou, we hebben dit en Matthew, we hebben eigenlijk... we hebben geen idee wat we aan het doen zijn.
Nou, interessante vraag. Toevallig was het vanochtend in de presentatie van Chris Seiden dat ze zei van, als je nu gaat kijken naar de mogelijkheden die komen met... Google Analytics, de web app variant die eraan komt met enhanced measurements. Heel veel zal out of the box, leuk term, out of the box gewoon beschikbaar worden gesteld qua datacollectie.
Ja. En ja, een uitdaging voor velen inderdaad van we installeren Google Analytics.
Ja.
Kijken wat hij doet. Ja. Bijzonder weinig in het begin. Of tenminste, alles op pageview niveau, dat track je.
Ja.
Maar qua events is het inderdaad lastiger.
Ja, inderdaad. En wat Google nu probeert te doen is dat we op basisniveau al wat scroll tracking mee te krijgen. Wat outbound link tracking, file downloads, video interacties, et cetera. Dat is prima voor een bedrijf die net begint met een basisimplementatie. Dus als je echt gaat kijken van waar bestaat hoe gaat het werk veranderen in de toekomst. Zal toch wel zich meer gaan richten op de migratieprocessen van bedrijven vanuit Universal Analytics naar de nieuwe variant. Dus dat gebaseerd op de Google Analytics voor Firebase. Toch wel de enterprise bedrijven. De migratieprocessen van meerdere landen naar een duidig platform waarop alles gemeten wordt. Dus dat, het wordt makkelijker gemaakt om mee te beginnen. Maar customization zal je toch wel als groot bedrijf moeten gaan nadenken over je investering in een goede datacollectie.
Ja.
En dan waarom ik dat zeg, is wat er vaak wordt vergeten binnen de kleine bedrijven, zijn topics als GDPR. Hou je wel aan de regels van wat er gemeten mag worden. Verzamel je niet te veel persoonlijke informatie binnen je data, binnen Google Analytics. Dus datakwaliteit is ook een onderwerp dat heel erg in opkomst is. Dat zijn dingen waar oplossingen zoals Segment nu al op ingespeeld zijn.
Google Analytics en GTM lopen een beetje achter.
Lopen een beetje achter, ja. En,
dat krijg je als je marktleider wordt, dan word je een beetje lui. Dan,
misschien...
Nou, met de veranderingen die qua Google Analytics eraan komen, zou ik ook weer niet zeggen dat ze lui zijn, zeg maar.
Nee, ze hebben wel gewacht en afgekeken van anderen en te kijken waar de trend heen gaat misschien.
Ja. Er verandert heel veel. Wat ik vanmorgen ook zei, ik ben regelmatig lost in Google Analytics omdat er weer wat veranderd is.
Ja.
Dus er gebeuren wel dingen, maar als je dat inderdaad qua datacollectie kijkt...
Als je bijvoorbeeld
is dat belangrijk dan?
het wordt belangrijk. Kijk, bedrijven die met 360 werken, daar geef je mee al aan. Je hebt een serieuze investering gedaan in je datacollectie. Maar waar Google Analytics en Google Tag Manager als producten, als tools niet in investeren, is enige borging in je datakwaliteit. En als je dan kijkt naar producten zoals Segment, ik haal het elke keer aan, maar ik vind het een mooi voorbeeld om te zien hoe de markt zich ontwikkelt. Dan schrijf ik ook een stuk uitgebreider op mijn blog van Segment pakt het anders aan. Die verzamelt die data en die haalt het eigenlijk een soort door een datakwaliteitsfilter. En die datakwaliteitsfilter is gebaseerd op jouw meetplan. Dus in plaats van lukraak een tagje op je website neerzetten en afwachten wat voor data er verzameld gaat worden. Wat er ook eerder tijdens een andere discussie is neergezet. Je moet plannen. Wat wil je gaan meten? En hoe wil je dat die data jouw database binnenkomt, zodat je later analyse op kan uitvoeren. Evines Kaushek die zei vroeger, crap in is crap out.
Ja.
Maar waar is die controle op die crap? Pardon my French. Maar je moet echt gaan kijken van, als er geen monitoring is zeg maar, op die data die binnenkomt, dan ga je ook heel veel problemen in een latere fase opleveren, wanneer die analyse wil uitvoeren.
Maar ja. Hoe kan de tool zichzelf controleren?
Om even een voorbeeld te geven hoe Segment dat doet. Je bouwt zeg maar in Google Sheets bouw jij een tagplan op. Binnen de tagplan geef je aan wat je wil meten. Welke events, welke parameters horen erbij. En welk format moet die parameters hebben. Een klant ID moet misschien bestaan. Beginnen met twee alphanumeric characters. Twee letters. Gevolgd door zes nummers.
Ja.
Als jij een waarde binnenkrijgt die daar niet aan voldoet. Op basis van regex die controle laat uitvoeren, dan wordt die inkomende call, die wordt geflagged. En dan kan jij achteraf binnen Segment gaan kijken van, waar is het misgegaan? Dus je kan die daadwerkelijke payload van die call zien. Kan je kijken, waar is het misgegaan? Dan kan je eventueel nog goedkeuren of afkeuren. Kan je zelf nog bepalen wat er met die data gebeurt, voordat het verwerkt gaat worden.
Precies. Dus ze zetten ze even apart, ze parkeren ze even.
Ze zetten het even apart. En ik denk dat wel, dat vind ik een van de betere features die ik liefst in Google Tag Manager zou willen zien. Ik heb iets geprobeerd te bouwen met Google, sorry met Google, het is wel van Google, maar met Firebase, real-time database. En met custom templates binnen Google Tag Manager heb ik geprobeerd om een soort data layer monitor te maken. Waarbij je zelf kan instellen van, joh, een parameter klant ID moet aan dit format voldoen. Gebeurt dat niet? Of is hij leeg? Dat is, regex is nu niet mogelijk binnen custom templates. Maar is die bijvoorbeeld leeg? Dan schiet hij een waarschuwing af naar Firebase real-time database. Gebeurt dat 3 keer binnen 5 minuten? Hmm. Dan krijg je gewoon een alert binnen Slack of welk platform je ook wilt. Je moet proactief bezig zijn met die datakwaliteit. Want zelfs bij een recent project is er pas na 2 weken achtergekomen, toen iemand bezig was met de analyse van die data, dat bijvoorbeeld de klant ID ontbrak. Voor een periode van 2 weken. Ja, voor een groot, voor een groot nationaal of Nederlandse e-commerce website is dat gewoon
onmenselijk. Ja, op zijn minst onmenselijk. En de vraag is dan, zit daar ook een bepaalde vorm van machine learning in? Dus klant ID's die niet kloppen, worden apart gezet, die verbeter je vervolgens en dat het te detecteren is dat elke keer als het begint met een B, dan is het toch wel goed, want weet ik veel, om wat voor reden ook, is dat een apart klant-ID?
Machine learning durf ik niet direct te zeggen. Ik denk dat hier gewoon een makkelijke functionaliteit binnen Google Tag Manager te bouwen zou zijn, los van een hack met Firebase erbij. Maar dat je inderdaad met bepaalde regex-voorwaarden die waardes kan laten controleren voordat ze überhaupt doorgestuurd worden naar Google Analytics. Want dat is in principe wat er gebeurt. Je moet toch eventjes die waardes ergens kunnen controleren. Voordat je je data vervuild gaat worden.
Nee, maar ik bedoel vooral dat als je die vervuiling eruit hebt gehaald, ja, en je corrigeert die vervolgens handmatig, dat onthouden wordt, zodat je steeds minder hoeft te corrigeren.
Ik snap het. Ja, ja, maar zou je dat wel willen? Zou je het niet bij de bron willen aanpakken eerder?
Oh, maar dat kan natuurlijk heel veel handwerk zijn dan.
Ja.
En dat is precies niet de bedoeling.
Nee, maar ja.
Dan bel je Matthew.
Ik wou net zeggen, dat brengt brood op de plank. Ja. Dus dat zijn inderdaad de issues waar dan naar gekeken moet worden. Maar of je nou gaat investeren in een machine learning oplossing om dat voortaan te voorkomen, of je gaat het gewoon in 1 keer goed zetten. Ik denk eerder dat de machine learning een te grote omweg is. Ik denk dat zoals met alles wat met data te maken heeft, je moet altijd goed naar die bron kijken. Wat gebeurt er bij die bron, bij de verzameling?
Dus je zegt meer op het moment dat je, nou, laten we zeggen, 5 keer een B tegenkomt in je klant-ID wat niet mag, dan moet je gewoon je validatie op je formulier aan gaan passen of iets in die zin gaan doen ten opzichte van, maar die fout blijven afvangen.
Ja, is in feite inderdaad. Ja.
Hey, wat is meestal de trigger van klanten om zich hiermee bezig te houden, met datakwaliteit bezig te houden? Zijn er grote dingen misgegaan? Of wat meestal, wanneer word je ingeschakeld?
Wanneer ze erachter komen dat er geen documentatie bestaat over waarom iets geïmplementeerd is zoals het bestaat.
Okay, dus er zijn al een paar mensen die wat gedaan hebben, die zijn vertrokken.
Ja, nou, inderdaad.
de bestaande mensen kunnen nog geen...
Ja. Nou, wat ik vaak zeg is vooral met tech management, het is geen, in veel gevallen, ik korrel je zout bij eventjes, is het geen fulltime job. Mm-hmm. Het is, ja. Het is aan de beginfase, neemt het heel veel tijd in beslag, doordat je een strategie moet gaan uitwerken, je moet een planning neerzetten, documentatie, implementatie.
Ja.
Nou, daarna krijg je een testfase, maar als alle problemen zijn opgelost, blijft dat gewoon geleidelijk doorlopen. Je hebt daar weinig omkijken naar.
Ja.
De klant kan bellen van joh, we hebben een nieuwe tag die moet geplaatst worden. Je gaat kijken van oké, nogmaals, je gaat weer door dat proces heen om het neer te zetten. En dan komt de data op een gegeven moment wel vanzelf binnen. Dus moet ik even een beetje neerdenken van...
Eigenlijk ben je een soort detective dan.
Ja, het is vreselijk veel debuggen. Het is vreselijk veel debuggen. Ja. En waar het dan uiteindelijk om neerkomt is dat de data wat binnenkomt, dat er uiteindelijk een keer naar gekeken wordt. In sommige gevallen echt na een jaar. En dat ze denken, jongen, er klopt hier iets niet. Waarom zitten deze waarden ertussen? De aantallen kloppen niet met een ander systeem waar we ook bepaalde conversies of events in meten. En dan moet er toch eventjes een oplossing voor komen van waarom is dat zo gebeurd en hoe kunnen we dit in de toekomst voorkomen? Absoluut, ja, een hele goede vraag.
Ja, en ik kom het zelf vaak tegen dat ik, dan kom je voor conversieoptimalisatie, zeg maar.
Ja.
Hopelijk niet alleen maar om een AB-test te draaien, maar hopelijk iets breder, zeg maar, ja, om inzicht te genereren in ieder geval en daar dan hopelijk op acties te ondernemen. Ja, meestal de eerste 3 maanden hou je daar helemaal niet mee bezig. Dan ben je bezig om die data op orde te krijgen. Van ja, leuk om inzichten te vergaren. Maar jullie meten niet wat jullie denken dat jullie meten. Of jullie meten überhaupt niet wat ik nodig heb.
Ja, maar wat je beschrijft is ook een probleem waar veel grote bedrijven nu tegenaan lopen. Is dat de analisten komen binnen. Maar die zijn 80% of 90% van hun tijd bezig met het opschonen van data.
Ja.
En dat komt weer terug naar het originele probleem. Van joh, je moet het bij de bron goed aanpakken. Zorg dat daar die data goed verzameld wordt. Dat het gevalideerd wordt wat er gemeten wordt. En bij fouten dat je meteen erin kan springen. Dus daarom denk ik nog steeds, weet je, je moet er vroeg bij zijn als het misgaat. En een groot, nog een tweede punt waar ik me ineens aan dacht van waar het vaak misloopt is, vooral bij de grote bedrijven, de internationale bedrijven, is hoe ze data verzamelen. Veelal zijn de websites in lokale talen vertaald.
Ja.
SEO-technisch is het natuurlijk gewoon een groot voordeel voor het bedrijf zelf. Maar als jij al die data in een lokale taal gaat verzamelen, productnamen, productmaten, productkleuren, specifieke pagina's, hoe ga je die data allemaal met elkaar aggregeren?
Ja.
Dus ook daar moet er dan vaak een oplossing voor gemaakt worden van... op het gebied van datacollectie.
Dit doet me denken aan, ben je bekend met Glue? Glue.io, dat is een e-commerce tool.
Altijd leuk om iets nieuws te leren.
Ja, het is een Amerikaanse tool. Ik heb ze laatst ook voor een podcast geïnterviewd.
Okay.
en we gebruiken het ook zijn het gaan gebruiken bij Vimo.
Ja.
Wat zij claimen te doen. Ze verzamelen data van vele verschillende bronnen. Ze zijn wel gespecialiseerd in e-commerce. Dus ze hebben wat koppelingen met onder andere Magento. Maar ook met Shopify volgens mij. En nog een hele host aan WooCommerce.
Ja.
Een hele host aan e-commerce platforms. Maar ook je e-mail marketing, CRM, je AdWords data volgens mij ook. En zij claimen dat zij een ETL proces hebben.
Claimen, Guido. Dat, werkt het?
Dat
willen we weten.
Nou ja, dat gaan we dus uitvinden.
Oh, dat gaan
we
uitvinden.
Maar ETL, extract, transform,
load.
Yes. processen hebben dat het allemaal gelijk trekt. Ik bedoel, het probleem is natuurlijk, als je al die dingen gaat samenvoegen,
dan
je denkt van oké, maar dat is in verschillende tijdzones, dat is in een andere valuta, de definities zijn anders voor users of dat soort ongein allemaal. En dat trekken zij allemaal recht, van al die verschillende systemen. En dan gaan daar, geef jouw inzichtrapporten dus, en ook lifetime value is een leuke die ze hebben, gespecialiseerd dus op e-commerce.
Okay.
Dus ik vind dat mega interessant. Nou, als het werkt.
Ja, nee, het klinkt als muziek in de oren. Het zou nog mooier zijn als je hun data weer kan importeren in Google Analytics om daarop product ID bijvoorbeeld.
Ze halen wel data uit Google Analytics. Ik weet niet of je kan exporteren. Dat weet ik eigenlijk niet. Dat zou inderdaad wel, dat zou inderdaad ook leuk zijn.
We hebben natuurlijk nu een gast in het café. Zullen we even switchen naar Engels? Is yeah. dat,
let's switch from English.
Switch to English.
Yeah.
I was gonna. It's okay. I was just gonna sit here and pretend that I understand everything that you guys were saying.
How's your Dutch?
Very well.
Yeah. Non-existing.
Yeah, not existing.
Just as
much.
Good as my Chinese.
Prolet, welcome.
Thank to you. The cafe.
Welcome to our cafe. We have a bar actually now.
Yeah,
could you introduce yourself? You just did a session, right?
Yeah,
you already did your keynote.
Yes, I was right before lunch. So hopefully people didn't leave for food before I finished. So I guess that was encouraging. My name is Prolet Miteva. I'm Senior Product Manager of Analytics at Autodesk.
Welcome.
I'm very happy to be here. I found out about CRO Cafe today, so
yeah. Welcome.
Now I've subscribed on Spotify.
On Spotify, all right.
Oh, instead of Podcast Addict, or
I did not find you guys on Podcast no. Addict.
Exactly. We have there's a gap apparently, and so we need to make sure that we're also on Podcast
in the United
Addict.
States. And we talked a little bit this morning, and you were telling us about your new talk. How did it go?
I think that. It went very well. I got some questions at the end, so that's usually encouraging. Yeah. There were a couple of people that stopped by and thanked me, so that is always good.
All right.
So from my perspective, it was a success.
Okay, good. Let's talk about those questions in a minute. But first, what was your session about? The title was Analytics is a Product, Let's Treat It as Such.
Yes, very.
I feel that there's a like a frustration underlying this.
Yeah. It wasn't that much frustration, really. What my talk was about bringing up the work that we do every day and making it more meaningful, making it more of a product than just an offering that we do usually. A lot of times what we do every day is more of services, it's more kind of doing small things for everyone else, and we don't treat the work that we do good enough. So my talk was probably a little bit more of an inspirational talk about changing.
Do better.
It's not about do better. It's more about changing the way you think about the work that you do. Changing your thinking from the fact that you're making a project, changing that into the fact that you're doing a product. Yep. So stop minimizing the work that we're doing and making it more meaningful for both the company and yourself.
Is it something we, as in the group of analysts, are we doing something wrong, or is it the way people view our work?
Yes.
I think it's both, but where I think it starts is from us. And that was one of the points of my slides. It was that we actually minimize the work that we do. A lot of what we're doing every day, and I went through some of the examples of the dashboards, new tools or platforms implementations, or running an optimization practice, those are actual products. Those are products that we provide to our business customers. And business customers, I mean our internal business customers, not our external consumers. It's more all the customers that we have internally. And we should think about our stakeholders more as customers. We as a company think of everyone outside as customers. We should start thinking also internally that everyone within our company is our customer. And if we start thinking more in that way, maybe we will treat our work a little bit more of like a product. So I went through the different stages of the product process and how kind of tried to show everyone that what we are already working on is very close to the product process. We're just not thinking about it as such. And trying to think a little bit bigger and trying to think about everything that we do every day as something that is more important can help us represent it in something that's more important and help our business customers treat it as something that's more important.
Yeah.
So it's both sides, but I mean, honestly, it will be really hard for us to quickly change what our business customer think about us, but we should first start changing what we ourselves think about ourselves
and how we
and our
communicate.
Work.
And in what ways do you think we minimize the work that we do?
First of all, we often think of it as that it's like one and done. We don't take the time to advertise it and promote it enough within our companies, and we don't take the time enough to grow it or to maximize our reach with the products that we develop. So when you create a dashboard or when you create a new tool, you need to spend the time to actually market it. And some of the things that I went through a little bit was when you create a physical product, you go through all the marketing channels that you can think about, right? You do SEM, you do display advertising, you do all of that in order to reach more people. But when we create an internal product, we don't actually try to take the time to go through all of these steps.
We throw it to them, say, yeah, we have a good time.
We throw them to them, we send an email or two, maybe we do a training session or two, but we need to take a little bit more effort to actually advertise it. I had some examples like making posters, doing little social events like
display
cupcakes.
Advertising.
Or, yes, the display advertising.
I think at a company at the in the Netherlands when mobile was up and coming, the lead CRO was dressed up as a mobile phone for a week at the ESM. I think they did a few years ago.
Oh, yeah?
Just to create awareness. Nah. Something like that. Yeah, yeah. To create awareness and have people ask him, what are you doing? Well, then you can explain it.
Guinness Book of World Records attempt on there?
Maybe.
Maybe.
Longest time. Yeah, not sure if that's a world record I would want to have, but.
Just to ask you a question, only three people raised their hands when you talked about planning. How does that differ in between different countries, different events where you ask the same question?
What was the question?
I asked how many people, one of the stages of the product process is plan. So I asked how many people plan about the things that they develop. And yeah, I was surprised.
Only
I think
three.
Honestly, they were not sure what I was talking about. The question was how many of you plan of how you're gonna make your product real, how are you gonna get that dashboard to be done. I frankly cannot accept that it only three people in the whole audience plan how to make things done. It's unrealistic. Every single person has that. Even let's say that it's a dashboard, something that you will create in couple of hours or a day, you still in your mind plan how you're gonna approach it. What are the steps that you're gonna do in order to complete it? What data are you gonna use? What visualizations are you gonna use? How you're gonna lay it out? How you're gonna actually then complete it? And how you're gonna send an email and be, in a way, in the release phase? And I think that people just don't realize, and I might need to adjust my presentation for one of the next times, to talk a little bit more about that process, because even subconsciously, every single one of us is planners, because otherwise you're not going to be able to complete anything. But
well,
yes, I was surprised.
Maybe subconsciously. I speak from experience from companies where I've done some work. A lot of people just start creating dashboards. They start creating the product, and they skip the planning part. And then so when only three people raise their hands,
maybe
it's realistic. Yeah, it could be. And it's kudos to those three raising their hands that, you know, but it does take effort. It does take self-control to take a step back, evaluate what you want to achieve, and create that planning for it.
Yeah, then I'm really surprised. And yes, with a dashboard might be simpler, but anything else, an implementation.
Oh, don't get me started.
You have to plan for that, right? Yeah. Especially if you need to start involving other teams, like engineering teams, you kind of have to plan. So I think that maybe people were confused.
But there's also there's a danger in just creating dashboards for people if you don't really know what they're going to use it for, right?
If they're going to use it at all.
Well,
if they understand
sure.
it.
No, but I've often given the example in the podcast that I once came in a company I think I mentioned it today already, but the report they had, the data they had, the e-commerce manager, what they saw on a daily basis was the number of orders that they got. Yeah. That's the only thing that they got. So they started just giving discounts to make those numbers go up.
Oh. Yeah.
And that. So you're trying to help them by giving them a dashboard, if the data is incomplete or not necessarily what they actually need, it can actually maybe even bring your company down if you. If you
at least you had transactions. I know of an international company, well, a pan-European company, who only used a number of users, visitors.
Oh, great.
Oh.
To evaluate the performance of their website.
All right, so no budget to CRO and all the budget to search engine marketing.
Can easily create a little bot and then it's like, yes, we're
where's my bonus?
Yeah. That's why then I'm actually probably surprised, because I would have thought that by this time, and I've been in analytics now for like almost 10 years, I would have thought that we're past the time where we have to ask that question, why? Right? And from my perspective, if you're an analyst, if you're a good analyst, if you're good at your job, you would be asking that question. So with your example and just showing orders, well, why? What are they trying to do? If they're just trying to increase orders, great. But I really doubt that that's the goal of the business.
Yeah. And so they were in multiple countries. So one of the countries, they were like a challenger. So they were new in the market. And that makes sense, right? You want to increase market share, you may even want or accept that you're losing money for a couple of years, maybe that's fine if that's a conscious strategy.
Yeah.
But not if you apply it everywhere for everyone. And
it reminds me of Avinash Kaushik's three whys process. I think it was Avinash. He said whenever somebody asks you for that you need to track some data, you have to challenge them three times and have them answer that question why.
Yeah.
Three times, you know, why do you want it? And they will give you a response. Ask why again, and try to drill down to the core issue that, or the core piece of information that they're after.
Yeah, or maybe five times, eight times.
Or more. Yeah. It is really amazing that, frankly, and we still get to talk about some of these things, which are basics in the digital analytics space, right? But the funny part is that we still talk about it. And we still talk about it like almost like it's new, and it's not. So I don't know why is that. Maybe more people need to go to more events like this and conferences, or listen to more podcasts.
It is. So we just spoke to Wim from MOA, the organization behind this conference, and the organization already exists 80 years, so far before we had something called the internet. But internet and having these amounts of data, that is still relatively new, right? So still trying to cope with having so much data and growing up. The digital analytics is growing up really fast because we have so much data, we can, and with great power. But in that sense, it's still, there are a lot of growing pains still in our industry. Yeah.
Oh, I agree. It's just that I would have hoped that we go past the basics and we start worrying a little bit more about, okay, great, you wanted to show this one metric on your dashboard, but now kind of what is the next level of data that you need in there to start making better business decisions? Yeah. What do you want to layer on?
And talking about that, how do you, what's your opinion on how CRO has affected data collection activities? I mean, I, from personal experience, I get the feeling that CRO is getting a lot more priority within companies than optimizing data collection. It's closer to your P&L. I mean,
which is weird
because a lot of CRO is dependent on proper data.
Yeah.
Yeah, but don't a lot of people see CRO mainly as the color of the button and an A/B test?
It's a lot more tangible for people.
Isn't that the first step that people think about when they think about CRO? And then the CRO guy, or girl, of course, has to tell them, I want to do that, but you do realize that the data I need isn't good enough or isn't sufficient.
I think Annemarie Klaassen spoke about it this morning. I don't know if you visited her session, but she spoke about, we also didn't visit her session because we were here recording a podcast.
You get a pass.
We spoke to her afterwards about this being a big problem, that a lot of people in CRO also don't really check if the data that they collect is actually what they assumed that they are collecting. So maybe there are a lot of assumptions that we are all doing, that the data is correct, or that we're even measuring what we are measuring, or a lot of people not doing sample rate mismatch checks before they start analyzing, and just hope, or well, assume hope that it's correct, and then either don't have the knowledge, or we don't have the budget for it anyway, so let's not bother. Or
Well, one thing I'll challenge, though, is being in a subscription-based business, which more and more of the businesses are in that direction. It's great to get the initial conversion, but if you don't retain that customer, then it really doesn't matter. For me, if you convert somebody and then they leave a month later, that is basically wasted money, because often, depending on the cost of your product, that conversion might have cost you more than that monthly fee. So as you get more and more, especially in the subscription-based businesses, starting to think about the retention, the renewal that the customers are doing becomes more and more important, because ultimately where you're going to be making the money is that when you get that customer, and then you have to stop thinking about them. You have to stop thinking about trying to onboard them. You have some process that gets them to stay. You have a product that's good enough that gets them to stay. So sometimes looking at that only initial conversion starts to become obsolete because it's not relevant for a lot of the companies. Granted, it completely is dependent on your business, but that's why some of the basic metrics, it doesn't matter. That's
an interesting point because I know from personal experiences, and that, you know, not on a company level, there are a lot of Dutch companies, and I think it's looking at Guido and you,
Bart.
The energy companies, they would offer premiums for new customers. So you would get a huge discount, or you would get a tablet at the time. Remember those tablets they were giving away?
The same with telecom companies.
Telecom companies. But only for new customers, not for the customers who are loyal and willing to stay. And that's what always got me.
So you're highly incentivized to switch every year. Yeah. Still.
It might also be driven by a data problem, because a lot of like Google Analytics, you're almost the default setup at least, and you lose them, you lose cookies. So the default setup is you can track them until their first order, and then we don't know.
But
and
it's also with the telemarketing of most of those companies, everybody's rewarded for the first sale.
Yeah,
nobody's rewarded for retention.
No, exactly. And that
so why would
your
you care?
Problem about retention?
Well, I think that you can do retention multiple ways. Obviously, if you provide too much incentives for switch, then the customer can go and switch multiple times. But at the same time, if you have a product that's good enough that customer doesn't want to switch, then it makes a difference. Okay, your electricity. Do you get electricity from one company or another? Probably doesn't really matter unless one of them has outages all the time. Then, honestly, no matter what kind of incentives they might want to give you, you're probably not going to switch. So it's about making your product better as well.
Well, here's an interesting one. You're from America. You know Amazon and Kindle, Audible, the audiobooks. Yeah. They have the most interesting model that I've ever seen. It's a subscription-based model, and you pay a certain fee, and you get credits every month, bimonthly, or maybe more than one a month, to purchase books. However, when you're a subscribing member, the prices of the books are reduced by a certain percentage. And what I figured out, it's not rocket science, but the prices of the books actually are reduced to a point where they're cheaper than the credit you just purchased.
Yeah, the credits, I think, are around $11.
Yeah, let's say $11.95, but then you can buy the book for $9.95. Yeah. So what do? You spend your credit and lose $2?
That's all. I'll always look at that. So
the
books are like more newer books, like over $25. Okay, I'll use credit for that. cheaper than 11?
Exactly. And then they have the WhisperSync. If you buy the Kindle version, it reduces the price to like $4.95.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And then I end up saving all my credits because I end up purchasing all. I'm paying money for the better deals that I'm getting as a paid subscriber. So I don't know what they're doing, but it's a very interesting model.
It's working.
See, though, there is also not an alternative service that you can actually get.
Yeah.
So
in
a way, they
can
do whatever.
But not as good as not for English speaking people.
So do you have any tips or advice for ways to promote your analytics inside the company?
As a product?
As a product, obviously.
Well,
except for wearing a special suit.
Well, my point was that first we need to start thinking about the analytics as a product and present it as a product to our customers and consumers. A couple of the tips that I gave was a little bit more around the launch and how do you go and try to promote it. So He was referring about my display advertising, which was making posters and putting them all around the company about that new product that you've developed, either dashboard or a new platform that you're integrating, doing a social event. Who doesn't like free food and free drinks?
Cupcakes. I saw the slide.
Yes, cupcakes. Yes, I wasn't sure if they're popular here.
Yeah. Of course.
So, yeah, they're still popular in the US. So, yeah, doing something where you can get people together to talk about the product that you've developed so they can be a little bit more receptive. And the other part was trying to kind of get your own influencers, own people that will do the reviews for the product that you've developed so they can spread the word for you. But it takes some planning, it takes some time, and I would tell you we're not perfect on that because always there is something new that you need to develop. And you are always kind of in that rush of, oh my God, let's do new things. And you really have to step back and allow more time for spreading the word and making things available.
How do you filter out the opinion of the boss and the real users?
Don't invite him.
Oh. That's an option. Yeah.
Are you meaning that the boss would not want you to do it?
No. You have your product, but yeah. Your boss might have an opinion about that product that he that conflicts with what the actual end users have in terms of wishes or of improvements.
The hippo effect you're referring to?
Yeah, I didn't want to use the word, but yeah, bingo.
Yeah, so. Okay, frankly, I'm probably known as probably a little bit of a too honest person at my company and around everyone that knows me. So I kind of don't give a...
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Rat's ass.
Yeah, okay, I wasn't sure how on what scale we're talking
not
here.
Public radio here.
Yeah, no. Not public radio. Yeah, no, I think it's much more important to make other people that are going to be actual users actually adopt your product than trying to worry about the opinion of your own boss. And frankly, if you manage to get other support, and that will make your boss look good in front of his boss because now people are adopting that product, I don't really think that there'll
be a
problem.
Yep.
But also, you should have told your boss to begin with. You should have told them, hey, this is what we're doing and this is why. A lot of times, depending on the manager, if you can put it either in two ways, either how it's going to benefit the business or how it's going to benefit them, it works. Depends how much
win-win.
That person. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
And ideally both.
Ideally, yeah. And Matthew, you joined the session. What's your main takeaway? Are you now productizing your services?
I have been thinking about it, definitely. I was very surprised about the planning, and that does kind of fall into place with what I've been experiencing. I do a lot of tag management, and when I come into companies, there's 9 out of 10 times there's no documentation. There has been no prior planning for the data collection activities that companies have been doing. But what I really liked, and I think it takes a lot of guts, and you focused on that during your presentation, is the retire part. Sometimes you need to let go and move on. And I think that's a critical part, especially if we're looking at the developments in tools like Google Analytics. We've had classic analytics, we've had universal analytics. So now for a lot of companies, there'll be a let go moment to move on to web and app. So I think that timing of your comment at the last piece of the process is very important. Yeah. And that companies will need to embrace that letting go moment and move on to web and app. As Krista Seiden said, the writing's on the wall. This is going to become permanent and companies will have to change.
So as in letting go of the tools you use for data collection or?
Moving on to the next version of the tool, yeah.
Yeah.
Because from what I understood, and don't hold me to it, but Universal Analytics at some point will be deprecated and everyone will need to move on to the web and app. So yep. And that's the letting go part that companies will need to take seriously in the next coming years.
Okay.
Yeah, no, definitely the let go part is important, and that's why I try to put it from the perspective that if you retire something, you get the full permission to do something new, innovate and create something new, and everyone should be excited about that. I would imagine that everyone who is working on Google Analytics implementations, they should be excited about the new stuff that Google is bringing in because, hey, for how long have we been doing Universal Analytics? I think it's now be like 5 years. aren't you tired of it?
I think I'll have a launch party.
Usually people are a lot more excited about new things than about optimizing the existing things.
There's a funny anecdote. I think I just wrote a blog post about it because Google Tag Manager just turned 7 years. And I'm often seen as the oddball at parties because I get very excited, enthusiastic about new releases in Google Tag Manager. But within my social group, nobody has
not
a clue.
So much.
No. Everybody looks like I'm speaking Klingon when I say, hey, did you see the new custom templates in Google Tag Manager? But we need to start using those things and carry on with what we're doing. And hopefully, possibly, improve what we're doing.
Yeah. You look at something that you currently have. If there is an opportunity for improvement, you improve it.
I think that's a great note to end the podcast on. Matthew Prodet, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I hope you guys have a lovely day and a lovely stay in the Netherlands, I would assume.
Thank you.
And we'll look for our next guest.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you.